Hello, everyone. I'm Dr. Leslie Kernisan, board-certified geriatrician and the founder of the website betterhealthwhileaging.net. And this is the Better Health While Aging video podcast, where we discuss common health problems that affect people over age 60 and the best ways to prevent and manage those problems. Now, today's episode is going to be a little bit different than the usual ones in that it is a follow-up on another recent episode. Specifically, it's a follow-up related to vitamin B12. So I recently published an episode on vitamin B12 deficiency. It's actually been very popular. So many thanks to those of you who have watched it or shared it and subscribed. And actually, if you enjoyed that episode or if you enjoy the channel in general and you haven't yet subscribed, please do, because it really does help the channel reach more viewers and it helps support the work that I'm doing. So about the follow-up, I want to address a follow-up question that many people posted in the comments, which related to what type of vitamin B12 supplement to take. Now, in the previous video, I explained that in most cases, you can either treat vitamin B12 deficiency or prevent it by taking an oral supplement of 1,000 to 2,000 micrograms per day. But it's true that in the United States, oral vitamin B12 supplements come in a few available forms, most commonly one of two forms. And so that led people to often be asking the question of which form of vitamin B12 supplement should they be taking, cyanocobalamin or methylcobalamin? Now, actually, that was not really the most common question. The question or comment that I saw several times posted was more like, doctor, why aren't you telling people that it's really important that they should be taking methylcobalamin? So it so happens that even though I didn't go into depth in this in the first video, this is something that I have researched, thought about, and looked into. And I do have an informed opinion about it. So I decided it would be worthwhile to record a short follow-up episode addressing this question, the difference between these forms of vitamin B12 and which one people should take. So specifically in this video, I'm going to start off by covering the main types of supplemental vitamin B12 that are available and how they differ from each other so you can understand that a little better. And then I'm going to go into what the research shows regarding cyanocobalamin and methylcobalamin for the treatment of vitamin B12 deficiency. And then at the end, I'll let you know which form I recommend and why. So let's get into it. So one resource that I found extremely helpful when I recently reviewed this topic is a scholarly paper that was published in the journal Molecule. So let me show you this article right now. So a resource that I found very, very helpful in researching vitamin B12 and preparing specifically to address this very common question is this article. This is a recent, very technical scholarly article published in the journal Molecules in 2022. The authors are a PhD pharmacist, and there are also authors from Italy as well. If you want to see where the authors are from, you would just click here. So you can see Faculty of Pharmacy in Slovenia and Department of Chemical and Pharmaceutical Sciences at the University of Trieste in Italy. So this is an extremely, extremely detailed take on different types of vitamin B12 and almost everything that you would ever want to know about it. What I think is especially relevant to the conversation or the question that I'm going to be addressing today is in this section right here, section 5. But if you really want to know all about this, this is a great resource, and I will post a link to it in the notes that are related to this episode. Now, let's review right now together the main types of supplemental vitamin B12 that are available. So for a long time, the one that was most commonly used is something that is called cyanocobalamin. So cobalamin is the technical name for vitamin B12, and there's often a little prefix before, which reflects what type of cobalamin it is. And if you wanted to see what this looks like in a sort of chemistry format, basically, vitamin B12, the molecule, has a fundamental structure, and then there's one extra spot where there can be a little add-on. And in cyanocobalamin, the add-on is a carbon and nitrogen, which is, you know, essentially cyanide. And in methylcobalamin, it's a methyl group. And I can show you what that looks like in a moment. So cyanocobalamin is actually a synthetic form of vitamin B12. It was first synthesized, I believe, in the 1950s. It is very stable, meaning it's pretty easy to, you know, keep on the shelf in a way or in supplements. It's inexpensive, and it has been used routinely by health professionals for decades. So this is the substance that has been used in clinical research for the treatment of vitamin B12 deficiency. It's been used as intramuscular injections. Even today, if you go to the clinic and they are giving vitamin B12 shots, this is probably what you are getting. And it also has been used as a high-dose oral supplement. So this is a form of vitamin B12 that we have a lot of experience with, and it overall has a very good track record. But there are other forms of vitamin B12. And actually, if you were to look at the vitamin B12 that is in meat, you would find one of three naturally occurring forms. And the form that is most commonly used right now as a supplement is methylcobalamin. Now, this can be more expensive often than cyanocobalamin, and it is generally going to be a little less stable as a supplement. If you want to know more about that in depth, that other article I was showing you, they go into depth on the stability of these different forms under different circumstances, which is relevant when it comes to the fortification of foods or the production of high-quality supplements. So it's less stable, as a supplement, but it does seem to be more bioavailable, meaning the body holds onto it a little bit better. And then there are some other forms that exist as well. And I'm going to speak to two others, which are the two other naturally occurring forms that we also often find in meat. One is adenosyl cobalamin. That's the form that is probably most prevalent in beef. And another one is hydroxocobalamin. And so let's take a look really quickly at what these look like from a chemical perspective, for those of you who are interested in that sort of thing. Okay, so this here is from Wikipedia, the Wikipedia page on vitamin B12. So this whole thing here is the vitamin B12 molecule. And this little spot right here that says R, that is the part that is different between the different versions of supplemental vitamin B12. So it can be the adenosyl group. It's actually technically a 5-deoxyadenosyl group. It can be a methyl group, CH3. It can be a hydroxy group, OH, or a cyanide group, CN. And so that is the difference. And that's going to be relevant because, as I'm going to explain to you, no matter which form you take in, when it comes into the body removes that little R group for a while. And then later on in the cells, that group will be added back, generally either a methyl group or an adenosyl group. Those are the forms that actually get used inside your cells. So in short, four forms of supplemental vitamin B12, and in the United States, the ones that are most commonly found in oral supplements are cyanocobalamin and methylcobalamin. And so again, to kind of compare them, so cyanocobalamin is the form usually used in medical clinics. It is the form that is referenced, for instance, in uptodate.com, which is the most commonly used clinical reference in the United States that is used by physicians. And then methylcobalamin is the form that, in my experience, has been historically often recommended by naturopaths, functional medicine providers, and other types of health providers. And it's been hypothesized to be better because it's one of the biologically active forms of cobalamin. It's a naturally occurring form of cobalamin. And the presumption has been that it must be more effective in the body. But the question really that we should ask ourselves is, do we have any evidence that one form of vitamin B12 works significantly better than the other? And that is what I'm going to review with you today. So what is the current scientific understanding of vitamin B12? Again, I would recommend, if you really want to know this in depth, that you check out that resource, that paper that I was mentioning, especially section 5.2. But here are some highlights in the section that goes through different forms of vitamin B12. And how they are processed in the body. So all four forms of vitamin B12 do get absorbed in the body, either through intrinsic factor or through passive diffusion for those people who may have pernicious anemia and are not making intrinsic factor. And again, if you are wondering what all that means, please take a look at the first video on vitamin B12 where I will go into that in depth. So all four forms do get absorbed into the body. And then they are converted to a cobalamin intermediate in the cytosol that's like within the cells. And this is very technical, but it will say that the ligands of the specific supplemental vitamin B12 form, cyano, hydroxy, adenosyl, and methyl, are removed. So again, that little R group that I was showing you in the diagram of vitamin B12, that gets taken off. Doesn't matter which form you took into your body, it will get taken off by the body. And then later, the intermediate is converted into methylcobalamin in certain parts of the cell or into adenosyl cobalamin in the mitochondria. So the conclusion of those authors was that therefore, for the greater part of the population, the bioavailability of all four vitamin B12 forms, cyanocobalamin, hydroxycobalamin, methylcobalamin, or adenosylcobalamin is considered comparable. Now, it's true that some people have a frank genetic defect, but otherwise we're all genetically a little different. And so for some people, some of that conversion works less well than for other people. And there are certain forms of genetic mutations that make it actually quite hard for people to convert most forms of vitamin B12 into the form that the body needs. But that is really a minority of people. And so that's why they say that for the greater part of the population, any one of these four forms of vitamin B12 should do the trick for your body. However, they also say that there is a growing body of research demonstrating lower tissue retention, higher urinary excretion, and consequently lower overall bioavailability of vitamin B12 when it is supplemented in the form of cyanocobalamin compared to the other naturally occurring forms. So what this means is that your body holds on to the vitamin B12 less well when it comes to the cyanocobalamin. You're more likely to pee out more of it. So it's a little less what we would call bioavailable. However, it should still function well in the cell. And then they also comment that some researchers suggest that the use of natural vitamin B12 forms, so hydroxycobalamin, methylcobalamin, or adenosylcobalamin, instead of cyanocobalamin for long-term supplementations to avoid the accumulation of cyanide in human tissues, which is especially important for smokers, as tobacco smoke is one of the major sources of cyanide. So what is cyanide? Cyanide is essentially a toxic substance, right? It has been used as a poison, or people can be poisoned by it. But it's important for you to know that in normal life, we are exposed to trace amounts of cyanide all the time. So if you smoke, you are bringing in cyanide into your body because it is a product of combustion, of burning. And when people smoke, they bring more of that into their bodies. But if you live in a city, you are surrounded by automobile exhaust, and that also contains trace amounts of cyanide. So just a little context if you are worried about exposure to cyanide through your vitamin B12 supplement. Let's now go on to what do actual clinical trials show us when it comes to vitamin B12 supplementation? Well, I've looked and there are virtually no randomized controlled trials that compare cyanocobalamin to methylcobalamin. I looked recently and the only one I found was a small trial that was done in children for the treatment of vitamin B12 deficiency in children. And they actually compared intramuscular injections of cyanocobalamin with sublingual cyanocobalamin and sublingual methylcobalamin. And I'll post a link to that. Essentially, the intramuscular injections worked faster. The methylcobalamin did result in a little bit higher level than the cyanocobalamin sublingually. But the difference was not enormous. And again, these are children, so how this would have carry over to adults is not entirely clear, but it would not be surprising if methylcobalamin was a little more bioavailable in older adults as well. And we do have many, many older trials showing quite successful treatment of vitamin B12 deficiency with intramuscular and oral cyanocobalamin. Now, newer trials that are being done related to vitamin B12 are increasingly using methylcobalamin. So that is now where the research is going. But in terms of a head-to-head comparison, for us to understand how much better is methylcobalamin than cyanocobalamin, we don't really know. What we know is that cyanocobalamin has a long track record of successfully treating vitamin B12 deficiency, and methylcobalamin works as well. So given all that, here is my interpretation of the science on these different forms of vitamin B12. Cyanocobalamin, again, has an established track record, and it is usually effective. In the vast majority of people, it will be effective. Methylcobalamin does seem to be, for most people, retained by the body better, and it doesn't have cyanide. So this means that methylcobalamin could be more effective in treating deficiency, and there's potentially a small health benefit in reducing exposure to trace cyanide. So methylcobalamin may be better, but as best I can tell, for most people, it's going to be only a little bit better, not a lot better. So if we are working with somebody who has a very severe deficiency, it might totally make sense to focus on methylcobalamin, but it's not clear to me that the research shows that there's going to be a huge difference between these two forms of vitamin B12 for the average person under average circumstances. So my answer to the question of which form of vitamin B12 to take is this. For oral treatment in most people, I think either cyanocobalamin or methylcobalamin is acceptable. I think what is most important is to get your vitamin B12 deficiency detected if you have one, and to get it treated. And either one is going to be okay. Methylcobalamin does tend to be a little bit more expensive. If cost is not an issue to you, I think there is a small advantage to methylcobalamin, and you can definitely go with that. And for those of you who are concerned about the toxin aspect of cyanocobalamin, again, remember that most of us are constantly being exposed to trace cyanide through automobile exhaust, some of us through smoking or secondhand smoking. If you do smoke, I would encourage you to quit, obviously, or through other combustion products. The other thing to consider is that it is possible that some forms of methylcobalamin are a little less stable and might degrade more quickly. So perhaps the quality of the supplement becomes more important. But essentially, I don't think it's worth getting too hung up on whether you should be taking cyanocobalamin or methylcobalamin. I think what's most important is to just get started treating vitamin B12 deficiency or taking it, you know, for prevention. If you are being treated for a deficiency, what is most important is to check vitamin B12 serum levels after a few months of treatment, because usually the question is, are you taking enough orally to get it in to be raising your serum levels? Most people, if their serum levels go up, the vitamin B12 will go up in the cells where it is needed. There is a very small minority of people who have genetic defects that are going to interfere with that process, but most of you are not going to fall into that camp. So if after a few months of treatment, you are not seeing that increase in serum vitamin B12 levels, what should you do? First of all, I would make sure that the oral dose is being taken consistently, right? Is the person taking their dose every day super consistently? And as I explained, this comes up for me caring for frail older adults. There are a certain number of them who have difficulty taking their medications every day. Next, if you think they are taking it consistently, you can consider increasing the dose. If they've been on 1,000 micrograms, we can go up to 2,000 micrograms or even more. As far as we can tell, there's not really an upper limit for how much vitamin B12 you can take. If you take in too much, your body pees it out, the excess. Or you could consider switching to another brand of supplement, because supplements are not, the production is not super well regulated. Some of them might be better produced than others. And then if this is a situation where a person has been taking cyanocobalamin as their oral supplement, you certainly could consider switching to methylcobalamin to see if you see more of an increase in serum levels. If the serum level has gone up, but you're still wondering, well, is this enough for the body's needs? Then you could check those confirmatory tests, which I explained in the previous video. The most common one we would do would be methylmalonic acid. So that's my take on what type of vitamin B12. I think methylcobalamin is probably a little better, but I'm not convinced that it's significantly better. And in general, when it comes to healthcare and medicine, I think it is important to sort of think about the law of diminishing returns, right? So the biggest value is in detecting vitamin B12 deficiency and starting to treat it. And in most cases, methylcobalamin instead of cyanocobalamin, as far as I can tell, is going to be a small benefit for most of you. So that is my take on it. So thank you very much for watching. I hope you found this interesting and informative. If you found the video podcast helpful and you haven't yet subscribed, please do. It really does help more people find the channel, and it helps support the work that I'm doing at Better Health While Aging. If you've been listening to the audio version on the podcast feed, come and take a look at the video when you get a chance. You will see my key points being displayed on the screen. So thank you once again, and I look forward to seeing you all again on a future episode of the Better Health While Aging video podcast.